Macmillan Audio presents The Friction Project, how smart leaders make the right things easier and the wrong things harder. Written by Robert I. Sutton and Huggy Rao. Narrated by Sean Patrick Hopkins. To Marina and Sadna, with our love, for the joy they bring into our lives, and for putting up with us even when we drive them crazy. Part 1. Setting the Stage. Introduction. Why friction is terrible and wonderful, and how you can fix it. The email, all 1,266 words of it, not including a separate 7,266-word attachment, popped up in our inboxes on a Monday morning at 9:14, before the coffee had begun to kick in. Sent by a Stanford vice provost to more than 2,000 faculty, it invited us to spend the following Saturday brainstorming about the mission of our university's new School of Sustainability. We love the new school, and were at first willing to give up a Saturday to help craft the mission. It's important to our students, faculty, and the planet. But the email left us annoyed and skeptical of any meeting convened by the big cheese who wrote it. That email was wordy, repetitive, confusing, and packed with defensive responses to picky past criticisms. Though it acknowledged how busy we all were, our struggles to decipher it sucked up more time than we would have thought possible. With a little editing, the email could have been cut to 500 or 600 crisp words and the attachment to 2,000 words or so. Time would have been saved, frustration spared. That leader's reputation wouldn't have taken a hit, and more Stanford faculty would have shown up that Saturday, including us. Anyone who has tangled with organizations as an employee or customer has had moments, days, and sometimes months and years when it felt as if the overlords who imagined and run the place have no respect for their time, such as encounters with systems that seemed designed to create maddening ordeals rather than give the simple answers, services, or refunds we need, or unbearable meetings with ill-defined agendas and clueless blabbermouths that stretch on for hours, or wrestling matches with rules, procedures, traditions, and technologies that once made sense, but are now so antiquated, pointless, and inefficient that they make you want to pull your hair out. All are forms of friction that chip away at our initiative, commitment, and zest for work, that hurt our coworkers and the customers and clients we serve, and that undermine the productivity, innovation, and reputations of our organizations. That's the bad news. The good news is that so much can be done to dampen the damage inflicted by friction problems, to reduce or eliminate such troubles, and to stop such ugliness from rearing its head in the first place. Every leader, whether you have influence over one or two people or over hundreds or thousands, can be part of the solution. The Friction Project is about forces that make it harder, slower, more complicated, or downright impossible to get things done in organizations. It's about why and when such friction is destructive, useful, or a mixed bag. Above all, it's about how to think and live like a friction fixer who makes the right things easier and the wrong things harder, so that work doesn't grind people down and drive them crazy. We call it a Friction Project because we have, for the last 7 years, made it our project to learn everything we can about the causes and cures for friction problems. Our goal is to help leaders craft homegrown projects that are tailored to fix the friction troubles in their organizations. Too much bad friction. We started this journey because we were deluged with stories and studies about the dark side of friction. We kept meeting people who were frustrated, pissed off, and exhausted by the organizations in their lives. No matter what we planned to cover during our research interviews, casual conversations, classes, workshops, and speeches, be it scaling, innovation, leadership, workplace jerks, or reinventing human resources, people kept talking about these soul-crushing obstacles and indignities. Here are a few examples. The healthcare CEO who bombarded thousands of employees with so many long, dull, and complicated email missives that they nicknamed him Dr. TLDR, too long, didn't read. The convoluted 42-page document inflicted on 2.5 million Michigan residents each year who applied for childcare, food, and healthcare support from the state. At 18,000 words and more than 1,000 questions, it was the longest benefits form in the United States. Much of what it asked for was unnecessary, intrusive, and sometimes downright obnoxious. Why would the state need to know the date of conception of a person's child? 300,000 hours a year. That's how much time executive committee members and their underlings spent preparing for the weekly XCOM meeting at a big company. Bain, the management consulting firm, found that more than 150 intertwined weekly prep meetings rippled through the company, which culminated in pre-meetings to brief each XCOM member just before the committee met. Then they all repeated the cycle again the next week. The exasperated service rep, who showed us that, to serve just one customer, she struggled to switch among at least 15 applications and 20 windows on the 13-inch screen of her company laptop. She was the victim of the unbridled IT managers at her biotech firm, who added more and more software applications to help reps do their jobs. Her company adopted so many efficiency tools that it rendered employees inefficient. The people who can get away with wasting your time. That's what a group of 60 energy executives agreed, after much moaning and laughter, was the right answer to our question, who are the most powerful people in your company? These friction horror stories rang true because our workplace, Stanford University, sometimes drives us crazy. Long and convoluted emails are just one problem. We are ground down by soul-crushing meetings, by oppressive rules and rule freaks that create ridiculous obstacles to raising and spending Stanford money, by the thicket of red tape for hiring and promoting faculty. In 2021, for example, to evaluate a fellow professor for promotion, our committee was required to create a 113-page document. It included 27 recommendation letters that we solicited from scholars and past students, as well as thousands more words and numbers that we and Stanford administrators had to produce and edit over and over to comply with a bewildering array of rules, traditions, and idiosyncratic preferences imposed by people who reviewed and approved the document. We attended perhaps a dozen meetings and sent at least 200 emails. And that was, as one colleague put it, one of easiest Stanford promotion cases in years. A beleaguered corporate manager from HP summed up how we all feel during such episodes. I am swimming in a sea of shit. I'm just trying to stay afloat. They want me to show initiative, but it is impossible. We aren't alone. Every workplace is clogged with destructive friction, which grinds people down and undermines performance. We set out to study this challenge and see whether we might be able to offer some solutions to the friction problem. We did case studies of companies like AstraZeneca, Uber, and JetBlue Airline that struggled with friction troubles. We conducted and collected academic studies, taught dozens of classes and workshops, and developed solutions to friction problems, including a meeting reset tool with Asana's Work Innovation Lab to help people eliminate and revamp bad meetings. Not enough good friction. We soon learned that the goal of becoming a frictionless organization is misguided. Yes, the people who run most organizations create too much debilitating friction, but many also ignore the opposite side of the coin, making the wrong things too easy for employees and customers. We certainly love how simple it is to order a ride from Lyft or Uber, rent a place from Airbnb, or order goodies from Amazon. But at times, organizations ought to make things harder or impossible to do. That's how the parents of 6-year-old Brooke Neitzel felt about their Amazon Echo Dot after Brooke asked this voice-activated gizmo, "Alexa, can you play Dollhouse with me and get me a dollhouse?" Alexa, the ultimate frictionless entity, promptly confirmed Brooke's $162 order for a Kidcraft Sparkle Mansion dollhouse, which arrived the next day. Brooke, understandably thrilled by this turn of events, declared her love for her virtual friend. Her parents were less enthusiastic. Unfettered and overconfident leaders can squander a lot more cash than Brooke did when they fall in love with flawed ideas and there are insufficient organizational speed bumps to prevent them from rushing their half-baked creations to market. That's what happened to Google co-founder Sergey Brin in 2011 when he became smitten with the cool Google Glass prototype, wearable smart eyeglasses with a built-in camera, microphone, and screen. The result was a textbook case of spending money as a substitute for thinking. Despite protests from the Glass development team that it was an unfinished prototype, Sergey rushed it to market with massive fanfare. The New York Times reported that at a Google development conference in 2012, glass-wearing skydivers landed on top of the auditorium, raced across the roof on bikes, and into the conference hall to thunderous applause. Once people tried to use the eyeglasses, however, the truth reared its ugly head. Glass was plagued with hardware and software bugs, terrible battery life, and unresolved privacy issues. Tech reviewers deemed it the worst product of all time. What might, with more thought and development, have become the next must-have device quickly became an avatar of uncool. Even Sergey soon stopped wearing it. Google pulled it off the market, and several disgusted and embarrassed members of the development team quit the company. The glass prototype wasn't the problem. The problem was it was too easy for the impatient and powerful Sergey Brin to do the wrong thing at the wrong time. There are other dangers to removing too much friction from the innovation process. We once heard a Disney executive complain about how much money and time the company wasted on developing new rides for their parks and new films, that the processes were horribly inefficient and needed to be streamlined. Yet, as piles of studies show, to do creative work right, teams need to slow down, struggle, and develop a lot of bad ideas to find a rare good one. During the 32 years that co-founder Ed Catmull was president of Pixar, the company produced a parade of hit films, including the Toy Story and the Incredibles series. Ed believes that if Pixar followed that executive's advice, it would kill the goose that lays the golden eggs. He wrote us, "The goal isn't efficiency. It is to make something good or even great. We iterate 7 to 9 times with friction in the process." Fad surfing also ought to be harder for leaders. An exasperated manager at a big insurance company told us that his CEO falls in love with every flavor of the month and every consultant who sells them. That manager had been taught design thinking, lean startup, agile management, and digital transformation, and was expected to somehow apply them all at once. He spent too much time in training sessions, task force meetings, and working with colleagues to hone the BS our executives want to hear, and too little time doing his job. Similar to Sergey Brin, it was too easy for those top bosses to make it too hard for their employees to do their jobs. Technologies, including Slack and Zoom, that are meant to remove friction, can also make it too easy for clueless leaders to inflict long and convoluted communications on colleagues and customers. We heard dozens of tales about senior execs like Dr. TLDR and our vice provost who didn't realize or didn't care about the burdens that their technology-assisted blabbing imposed on their colleagues. In other workplaces, managers weaponize technologies to make their jobs easier and everyone else's harder. Administrators who used to shield doctors, lawyers, and scientists from red tape, such as approving budgets, expenses, and timesheets, now use software that heaps such chores on the people they once served. Arizona State's Barry Bozeman shows that more and more of us are bogged down by such robotic bureaucracy, those relentless computer-generated administrative demands that cause death by 1,000 10-minute tasks. Warmth, caring, and human connections are also hampered when organizations remove too much friction. The leaders at Jumbo, a big Dutch supermarket chain, figured out that many older customers enjoyed their short interactions with cashiers. And because many were lonely, they felt such conversations were too brief. And with more Dutch stores using self-service counters where customers scan their purchases, grocery shopping now often entails no human interaction at all. So Jumbo, as part of the Dutch government's One Against Loneliness campaign for seniors, experimented at one store with a slow checkout lane for customers who were not in a rush and wanted to linger and chat with the cashier. This experiment was so successful.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.